Welcome back to the Football Fitness Federation podcast. This is episode 91. I am delighted today to be joined by Pierre Barrieu. Pierre, thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you. You're welcome. Thanks for having me on the last time.
That's awesome. Yeah. There was a little bit of pressure on that going live with the podcast, but hopefully I got it right. Thank you very much for coming on, mate. I really appreciate you giving up your time. It's going to be great to chat with you and go through your career. So, do you want to? I didn't mention you. You are a high performance expert and consultant. But with that, we're going to dive back into your career so far and go into some of your experiences. So, do you want to just take us through the roles you've had, where you've been, and take us up to current day?
Sure. I'll go quickly. I'm originally from France, moved to the US after World Cup 98. You know, back then, I don't know how it was in England, but back then there wasn't much other than my university teacher, you know, dealing with conditioning and football. Let's call it football for this podcast, just to be clear. Makes it easy on me. I coach in the US at the university level at Virginia, which is, and when I say coach, we're talking my area of expertise, obviously performance, that's why I'm here with you guys today. But I've also done some quote-unquote regular coaching times. So anyway, I was at Virginia for 3 years. I was with the US Soccer Federation for 11. Most of these with the national team as the head of performance for the federation. I went to the UAE for 3 years, same role, assistant coach, national team, head of performance. And then I embarked on a more regular coaching career, you know, which means by regular, I mean unstable. Briefly was at Sheffield Wednesday, started working for FIFA as an instructor. Which I still do, went to France, Norway, England again in the Premier League, briefly at Swansea, and then I've been with the Galaxy since August of 17. This finished, so this year I didn't want to dive into the club environment, so I'm taking a little break. I'm doing a lot of professional development. I'm taking the time to do things like the one we're doing today. And I'm also involved with FIFA a little more this year as part of a high-performance ecosystem analysis that they have worldwide for 2020.
Awesome. It's really interesting to get your thoughts and opinions on that club environment, because we've spoke to a lot of people before. It can be quite an unstable environment, can't it, like you touched on then. So what's your general views on that? Is it something that you're going to look in to go back into in the future, or are you looking at other avenues?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think so. You know, I'm still young. I've been around, you know, I started young. You know, that's the thing. You know, I started young, so I've been doing it for 20 plus years. I started when there was no one, you know, pretty much in the world of performance. And so I'm looking, you know, we all love it. You know, I don't want to talk for other people where I was about to say we miss the field, but, you know, I do miss the field, the day-to-day, you know, I've been with national teams for a long time. It's a different pace and I love that pace. You know, and a lot of people prefer the club environment. For me, it's fine. It doesn't matter. You know, I'd be fine with the national team. But to answer your question, yes, I'm looking to go back. But the instability and all this, you know, we have different stages in our life. You know, I have 3 kids. We moved a lot. So it's interesting because now one, you're down to two in my case, and you see things differently. You know, it's just not as much of a headache anymore, almost overnight. So yeah, obviously looking to find the next challenge, you know, within a club, because this is what I love.
And can you go into any more detail on your role with FIFA? Is there anything in particular that you can, any information you can give? What does that look like, your role?
Sure. I've been an instructor. First of all, I've been an instructor for FIFA since 14, as I mentioned. So I was running this session, this coaching session, mostly on the physical side. It was called physical preparation, integrated physical preparation and small-sided games. So this was a course designed for countries that didn't have access to much technology to, you know, to give them the knowledge so that they can tilt the sessions, you know, on the physical side more or less. So I'm talking in the past, at the past tense, because this year FIFA decided to really go to a new direction in terms of this professional development, all these courses. So the phase one of this new era is to do an audit of what's going on in 2020 in the world in terms of youth development. So I'm fortunate to be part of this ecosystem analysis. It's 15 of us. Some of them you may know, like a Steve McLaren, for example. So there's a panel of ex-coaches on the boys' side, or on the men's side, and the women's side, national team coaches. There is two physical instructors. I'm one of them. And there's also some people coming from the private sector. You know, the one thing we have in common is the football, but we have some high exec at Nike, for example. So we are coming from football, but we have different view. And then, you know, once we get this set of data after having analyzed all these countries, I think we're going to be doing 191 countries. So it's 15 teams. You do the math, you know, the world, you know, we each have a little part of the world. Then there will be a different set of eyes, you know, to look at this data so that the final conclusions should be pretty pretty thorough.
That sounds awesome. And you mentioned before we started recording that COVID has had a big impact on that, because it's affected travel and all the rest of it. So I guess it's switched the way that you've got to work and work with these countries.
Yes. I mean, yeah, of course. What a timing, you know. And then, you know, the options were, you know, once we actually had we've been having workshops, you know, to prepare for this analysis. And then obviously during the last workshop in Zurich, actually the workshop was supposed to be in Rome already and get moved to Zurich, because this is early March. And then obviously this is where the pandemic started, you know, the travel ban, and I had to fly back to the US. And eventually we decided that, you know, the on-site visit would be replaced by online analysis. So, you know, it doesn't change much, because we are talking in average, you know, to 15 to 17 stakeholders, you know, in each different member associations. It's a little bit more of a organizational, help me out with this one, headache when you have to do a video conference, you know, as opposed to moving from an office to another. But yeah, so this is you know, the goal of this is to we forgot to mention what's the most important part of all this, is that this 2020 analysis is going to lead to data, and then it's going to be the base for future content for future development courses, and this would be caters to each country needs. An example, you know, I don't know if there's a you're going to cluster countries that needs a lot of support when it comes to high performance, you know, and then develop these new courses adapted to their needs, and then eventually deliver the course on site.
Well, that sounds amazing. That sounds like it's going to really develop the sort of structure of what's going on behind the scenes in football as a whole, doesn't it? And it'd be really interesting to see some of the findings of that.
Yeah, I mean, our motto is give every talent a chance, you know, and then have every country reach their potential. So as you know, it's UEFA is a juggernaut. I mean, we all know this. It's a vacuum, you know, when it comes to talent, when it comes to everything else. So FIFA want to make sure that, you know, they provide the world, you know, literally the world, you know, what they need in order for them to get better and to make football more competitive all across the world. And so that the kid that grows up, you know, I don't even know about the kid that grows up in Niger. The kid that grows up in Niger is not my country. The kid that grows up in the desert, like 1,500 kilometers from the capital city, has a chance to not only be noticed and then, you know, grow and develop just like any other kid in this country.
Yeah, that's awesome, because there's plenty of talent out there, isn't there? But one thing that we were going to dive into, Pierre, and get your view on is, and coaches, well, especially students, people getting to the back end of degrees or possibly even postgrads very early on in careers, or even people within jobs that are still early within a career, this is the time to sort of listen up and get your notepads out, because we're going to dive into some of your advice for people in those roles. And the big thing in reference to that is, what do you feel that is missing in the university setting on these courses that are available that practitioners are going to need to work day to day in a club environment?
Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously we've talked about, you know, some of the topics we will discuss during this the podcast, and that's one thing I've had in mind for a while, you know. So I can answer the question in terms of this is what's missing, because I'm not part of these curriculums yet, you know. The one feedback I can give, and I've reached out to university here in my area in Southern California, is what I've observed for the many interns I've had over my years. So basically, and again, it's never a generality, but overall, you know, I've noticed that a lot of the interns I get, you know, have knowledge, you know, are knowledgeable, no question about it, are very eager, you know, and so they're willing and able, let's put it this way, and they have something to offer. You know, so that was the given. Now, on the other side, I've also noticed over the years that very few of them were ready to be inserted, you know, all of a sudden, you know, into a team environment. And this is what gets me thinking, is this, you know, what's missing out there? And then my conclusions over, you know, I would say a sample of, you know, 20 to 30 students that I've had throughout my time in different clubs and different countries as well, by the way, is this, you know, they're missing what they don't get over there, which is a practical experience, you know. So some of them can make up for this because they come from football, let's say, and because they come into a team with an idea of what the team dynamics are. Not so much the coaching dynamics, because, you know, they haven't been on that side yet. You know, obviously we're talking team sports. Team sports are different than individual sports. So, yeah, I think what's missing, it again, is it's not common sense, but I would say emotional intelligence, you know, social skills around in a team environment. You know, pick your time, you know, who you're going to talk, at what point the hierarchy in the teams, you know, getting a feel for, you're not taught this, you know, this is something that you have to develop the eye for it. You know, you take a look at the locker room, and then you know who's the leader, who are the followers, you know, who's introverted, who's extroverted, you know, and then how to approach these people and when, you know, and what to say. So that part is missing. I'm not sure I can be taught. I'm not sure how it can be, how they can be better prepared for it, but, you know, it's worth a try, you know. And in my case, you know, if I can be part of these curriculums and then deliver, you know, obviously much more in them than what we're talking about right now, but, you know, giving them tips and clues about what to do. You know, I've had a system myself that, you know, we're trying so hard to be, again, because people are eager, they want to fit in, you know, they know that, hey, if the player like me, they're going to be, I'm going to be well perceived, and it's going to be easier for me. But guess what? Sometimes this is not really the case, you know. Players can read through people, you know. So when you're coach, you're not a player. So there are some boundaries that you have to respect. So all that stuff that I've observed over the years, that, you know. So mostly it's mostly on the human skills, you know. It's the rest is they have the hardware, you know, they're missing the software. And get that. I know it's vague. I don't have any. I hope you get an idea of what I mean. But yeah, that part is hard. And I can give you so many practical examples. Again, I got a coach that was trying so hard to fit with the players. You know, and it was a national team during the World Cup. The players have a nickname for him. I've been telling him, listen, I know you. I know you're young. I know you're very happy to be here, and you're good at what you do. You're trained to help. It's a way to do it. You know. Don't cross that line. You know, the players read through it, you know, and eventually I told him, listen, you know, the players have a nickname for you. And they really said, yeah, huh, what? I said, they nickname you 24. And I said, what, 24? What do you mean? I said, yeah, there's 23 players on the roster. You're trying so hard to be one of them that they are like, okay, here's 24 coming, you know? And he couldn't see this. So once you've lived it once, you know, if you are, again, if you're smart, if you have these self-reflection power, you know, which all of us need, then lesson learned, you know, which in this case was the case. But it's even better if you don't have to go through this.
Yeah, I think it's great, and this is where it becomes really important to draw from experiences and experienced practitioners like yourself, doesn't it? That have witnessed this sort of environment, but at the same time, I think, and I'm sure you'll probably agree with this, is that people do have to experience it. They've got to be in that environment to know exactly what it's like and experience, hopefully not to the degree like that, but make mistakes and be involved in it and see exactly what it's like and develop their own sort of their own sort of experiences on it, don't they?
Yeah, and yeah, 100%. And it's even harder now, I would say, nowadays than it was, you know, when you know, let's say I have a national team, the U.S. national team, this is 2002, you know, and I'm a one-man's band, you know. I mean, there's no fitness coaches in MLS. So you end up going right and left, and then, you know, you're doing everything that you have staff for now, you know. I used to do it myself, obviously. So it wasn't as thorough, and the technologies were different, you know. But now, if you're part of a staff like this, you're so your skill set is so specific, you know, that obviously it's easier to slip, you know, outside of, you know, what you're supposed to do, you know. And you're also judged by the players more harshly because this is what you do. You better be good at it, you know. And then, you know, don't try to do what other guys is doing. That's why the head of performance is now in charge of making sure that the players and the staff understand that we are a team, you know, and that's the way I see things. I'm not, you know, I'm not for the compartments, you know, this is what he does, this is what he does, this is what he does, and this is it. This is very French, for example, in France, you know. Well, I'm saying France with the English accent, France. In France, I mean, this is really, you're a fitness coach, you do fitness, don't even tell me about, you know, formation or anything else. The way I've been used to and developed to some extent, you know, is mostly in English countries, you know, whether it's the UK or the US, and the coaches I've been around, most of them have been you know, and I go back, Bob Bradley is a perfect example that he integrates every part of his coaching staff, you know, and you're not reduced to, you know, what your primary skill set is, you know. You can, we have a dialogue, and then the players can see what's happening, and then I think it flows much better, and that's what I've been trying to do with my performance staff.
Yeah, it makes sense, doesn't it, that we understand, and this is a real common topic that we've had in the last few episodes, is that people have to all be pulling in the same direction, and everyone has different skill sets, don't they? But we have to understand the different roles and fit in with each other, because it isn't just a case of bouncing players from one practitioner to the other. We've all got to work together, haven't we? And that cohesiveness is really important.
Of course, you know, I mean, listen, you lead by example. So if you are structure, if you are cohesiveness, you use the term, if the understanding, you know, the system, whatever, you know, among the performance staff, number one, and from the head of performance to the coaching staff, number two, if this is not fluid, then don't expect, you know, the players, you know, really leading by example, you know. So if you tell them, hey, we have a coaching staff, the door's always open dialogue, you know, encourage and recommended. And if they see that there's no such dialogue between the coaches, and you know, I mean, all of a sudden you're doomed from day one. So clearly, yes, there has to be, I mean, that's the way I see things, you know. And I think, just like you said, I think this is what makes sense. There has to be clear lines of communication, you know, and yes, there should be a hierarchy, you know. That's the downside, because when we have clear lines of communication, when everybody's got a primary responsibility, but also a role to play in other, you know, like areas, sometimes you don't want this to, you don't want to send the wrong message that, you know, everybody can do pretty much what he wants at any time. That's not the case. There's always this hierarchy that's got to be clear, but in the meantime, you know, everybody should be within the coaching staff, should be able to voice an opinion at any time. You know, this is why, you know, I've been around coaches. One is a very famous player, and I can name him. Listen, it's Maradona. You know, when I was in Dubai, you know, and you know, I could see that the people that he had around him was just like almost like, you know, it was like a god for them, you know. So you know, they were not exactly, you know, if Diego said, you know, it's raining today, then it's raining, you know.
I think we'd refer to that as like a yes man. So they just agree with everything that he says.
Yeah, you know, and again, you know, the main moral about the Maradona story is this, you know. You want to have, to be successful, you want to have people around you that they are able to challenge you. You know, what's the point? I mean, you know, the secret is to find people that are smarter than you, literally to be in your staff. You know, now it requires you don't want to be insecure. You know, because this is what, you know, they say, for whatever reason. Oh, okay, I'm not going to get this guy. You know, I'm in my job. Sometimes my job is going to be in trouble. And this is also, yes, men's. Sometimes are just people that are afraid to be either like discovered, because you know they're not good enough, you know. And then, so you know, I don't think you're born a yes man. I mean, you know, they develop that strategy, you know, for some other reason, you know, or you're just not smart enough, and you just this is who you are. But that's rare. And in this case, it was just, you know, this is maybe no, because he wasn't even an Argentine coaching staff, you know, so they were from other countries. So it's not like this was the idol in front of them. But for me, I've learned from all the coaches around me that, you know, you have to be challenged. Sometimes, you know, sometimes it's not easy, because you have to be able to have real conversation, you know, and just like the players have to do, you know, you have to tell your teammate, or you have to tell, you know, some other coaches, or you have to be able to receive from the coach above you that, hear things that you may not want to hear, you know. But that's what efficiency is in my mind, you know. You tell, you know, if you're here to tell people what they want to hear, you never go too far, and a team doesn't go too far, and as a person or a professional person, you know, you get stale. So that's what I try to do. I try to surround myself with experts in their fields, and I try to encourage positive dialogue.
Yeah, I think that's the way forward, isn't it? And there's a lot that comes into it. There's ego, there's the culture of different clubs and coaches. There's a lot that comes into that, isn't there, to create that environment?
Yeah, again, we talked about the human skills. You know, you talk about seeing through people, you know, that was missing from some of the people coming straight from the university. That's also a challenge for someone in my position. You know, I ran this global search when I arrived at the Galaxy for the um, for the performance department. And literally, I wanted this to be global, because I've been a victim in the past of clubs not doing, you know, not looking around to see what the talent was. And, you know, let's face it, you know, nowadays they still, in many cases, if a position's open, it's, you know, does the head coach know someone, or does he know someone who knows someone? And I think, because, like I said, you know, I've seen it happen. For one position to build a staff, I really didn't want to reproduce what I'd been a victim of. So I went global because I had the means, and it was okay. Then I had the green light from upstairs. And it took me a lot of time, it's a good thing to go out there and say, let's see, we're gonna run an ad, and we're really gonna look at all the CVs. It's not like we're running an ad even if the position is already filled, you know. And yes, it took me a big part of my off season receiving all these CVs and looking through them and making a selection and doing 10, you know, Skype interviews. And then another round of five. And then finally, when you're down to three, you know, it takes a lot of time. That was for one position, and we had two. We had the head strength coach, and we had the sports scientist. But at the end of the day, you know, you get to the three, and this is where this strategy has its limits, because, you know, you have three great candidates in front of you, you know, and you're making decision based on instinct, based on gut, based on what kind of individual you have in front of you. And sometimes it's just, you know, like this, you know. And but it's better than calling someone, hey, I've had this, do you know someone? Because if you're a big club, if you have resources, come on, man, you should put yourself in a position to see what's out there and recruit, you know, the best person available.
But just to dive into that a little bit more, I suppose when you get into those small numbers, like you say, it can be a bit of a gamble, because you might have three superb practitioners, superb people sat in front of you, and you could have taken all of them. So not so much, I'm not referring so much as those final candidates, but I think it'd be great just to, if there is anything that sort of catches your eye, whether it's on CVs, whether it's when you speak to people, what is it that gets them through to the next stage from your point of view?
You know, it's depending. Again, I can only talk for the position I was in. You know, it was because everybody is different. You know, different club, different stages. You know, I was looking for someone with experience, for example. So that would be the thing that would look in the CV. So other than that, you know, there wasn't anything that would catch my eye on CVs. You know, once you get to this first list and then you talk to people on the phone and then you see them on video, for me, it was just to try to identify how genuine the person was, you know. So again, we're going back to the human side of things, you know. Is it someone, the someone I have here, is it, you know, is it really who he is? Or is he trying to be someone else during the interview? You know, is he trying to show off? Is he dropping names? And if he's dropping names, maybe because, is it justified or not? You know, so no, there's no real rules. But for me, it was, again, trying to identify what type of person I have in front of me. You get to the point where the skill set is similar. You know, you get to the point when we have, let's say, someone who's been in a position for, you know, 5-10 years, so he knows the job, he's had results, you know, he's been to different, you know, for us, he was obviously having the ability to travel, you know, when you move to a different country, to the west coast of the US, you know, what's your family situation? So, like, usual criteria. Again, the way I look at things is, do I have a good person in front of me? Is it someone that could come here and then work hard, and someone that can be a part of the team? Someone, you know, is it trustful? And then, you know, that's the way it went. And very happy with the selection we've made back then. I'm not part of it anymore. The guys are still there, so that's I guess that's one more way to show that this search was led and then produced the result expected.
And I know that was a tough question. There wasn't going to be specific answers because it is subjective, isn't it, to what gets put in front of you. But it was just good to get your point of view on it.
Yeah, I mean, it has to be subjective. I mean, if it's not, then, you know, I mean, if it's just checking boxes, and then, you know, I think this is just absolutely counterproductive. There's no point doing the search, you know. So early on, the interpreter has to apply. And then it's, you know, team sports, you know, it's a team sport with different people, you know, it's sociology. So, and you make decision at the end and you hope it's the right one. There's no certainty it is because you have three, you know, in that case it was three, it could have been five, very good options in front of you. And, you know, this is like the bachelor on TV on the bachelorette, you know, one, every other time, you know, you pick one at the end and then he goes back to the previous one. We can do that.
I could pretend that I don't know what you're talking about, but I know exactly what you're talking about.
Oh, you do. I can tell.
No, I think to dive into a good plot to dive into now, taking into consideration the clubs you've worked with and the practitioners that you've worked in and the different approaches of coaches as well, would be periodisation, something that's talked about a lot, and there's obviously a lot of different approaches to it and a lot of different strong views on it. But generally, if we start as a general point of view on periodisation from your perspective, and then we can dive a little bit more into your approach.
So, you know, it's periodisation is one of these themes, you know, that, you know, exist around the world of high performance, and to be fair, and it's also something that over the years, you know, my view has changed on, you know, and I'm not the only one. I was listening to, I think it was Darren Burgess, maybe like last week, that was saying that, you know, how have you evolved in your coaching? And Darren and I, we're probably the same age. I remember, like, we met in the bush in South Africa, you know, before the World Cup of 10, when we played a friendly against Australia. So, and he said that, you know, he's probably not as much set in his own ideas now than it was before. And he understands that, you know, you have to be flexible, you know. And that's periodization for me. I was a little rigid, you know, when I started, when I thought that this has to be planned. Going back to what we're talking about, people coming out of university, you know, we have a tough time, you know, like putting everything in perspective. But really, I want to say that overall, over the last, you know, 10, 15 years, I haven't been a big fan of periodization, to be honest with you. I mean, I use it, but this wouldn't be like a priority in my you know, Mourinho was in the same case. You know, he got it, like the tactical periodization was imported by the Portuguese school. And I was reading something, an interview from him maybe a year ago. He said, you know, he's been coming back from it, and now, you know, he doesn't pay as much attention or use it as much as in the past. So for me, national team was a whole different animal compared to a club team, obviously. Less camps, more time to plan, and then you get these 6 weeks leading to a major competition. So during these 6 weeks, I would use a stair theory, you know, which is to some extent what I'm using with the club team now. So I got mesocycles, you know, 6 to 8 weeks. I don't believe that you should, in September, dictate your volume and intensity, you know, or of what an April practice should be. You know, I really think it's just, I mean, we talk about the instability of a club environment, of a coaching staff and stuff, and I think it's just unrealistic, you know. So like I said, I break it down by, let's say, 4 to 6 weeks, adjust the volume, unloaded week, you know, that's one way you can say it. Obviously, we don't completely unload, but I try to go by this theory, you know. There's also some big words out there. I mean, you know, You know, I used to call it the wave theory, you know, when you don't go too high, don't go too low, which is, and now I was saying like the, a few days ago during one of the webinars, I don't know if it was a joke from a friend of mine, but he was talking about the undulating wave periodization model. I was like, wow, you know, or undulating reciprocal periodization model. I was like, yeah, wow. Used to be the wave theory, you know? So yeah, I mean, I break it down. Mesocycles, deal with the intensity and the volume, have unloaded week. And that's from a team's perspective, best case scenario, because as we know, you know, I think we may be talking about fatigue. You know, as we know, this is a very individual topic. So I start from the individual, you know, and then my periodization is more, you know, a product of what I have in front of me. Knowing that what we do influence these guys, but there's so many other factors that we can control and that we don't control yet that I think it'd be foolish to project yourself in the future, you know, when results, injuries, situation of the field can occur.
Yeah, and fatigue is something that we did want to touch on, and I think it's a really relevant topic right now as well, because with a lot of clubs, a lot of coaches going back into training, and depending on obviously where people are in the world, over in the UK, we're not far from restarting a season now. We're going to go into a quite hectic period. There's going to be a lot of games in a short amount of time, which is going to cause a lot of fatigue, and players have been basically in control of their own training for a certain period. So what's your approach of keeping players fresh, and what would you be looking at as well, and what would be some priorities in this time, which is quite a unique time?
Yeah. You know, I don't think it's specific to this time. This time was specific in terms of the stress they went through, you know, that we've all been through. But, you know, fatigue is a fascinating topic because it's such a vast, you know, and vague, you know, topic at the same time. So, you know, you mentioned, you know, what's causing fatigue. So, yeah. I wrote my thesis 20 years ago on cramps, you know, on the cramps etiology, you know, what's causing cramps. And here we are literally 20 years later on such an important, you know, what's the word in English? Pathology, to some extent, that we witness all the time, you know, debilitating pathology. And I don't think we know more about cramps now than 20 years ago. Actually, I do, we don't. So what's causing fatigue? Yeah, I mean, we know what's out there. You know, it could be the hydration. We can control that. You know, the lack of sleep, can we control this? Yeah, we could to some extent. You know, does he have sleep apnea? You know, does he have a medical condition? So these are the easy ones. You know, all the things we have in our system, you know, to overlook. It doesn't eat well. Well, we can fix that, you know. The overtraining, I'm not a, you know, I always say there's no such thing as overtraining. It's only under recovery. You know, that's the way I see things. So overtraining, I can mention it, but you know, like I said, you can control this. The weather you can control. That's one thing. You know, and then you go to the subjective one, and that's trouble, you know. The objective we talked, so that's these are the ones which have an effect, but all the subjective ones, and this is where now we have protocols in place, but this is where it goes down to the single individual, to the player, and that requires the human skill that I keep referring to. It's like a broken record. That required a common sense approach. And even so, you know, a lot of time now they talk about fatigue is sleep deprivation or deprivation in English? Not sure.
Yeah, deprivation,
you know. But, you know, is it what fatigue is? You know, it's not that simple, because you can be fatigued for all some other mental aspect, you know, if let's say there's someone is sick in your family, you know, all that stuff. So it's a little more complicated than sleep. And then the I mean, if you look at the the athlete that you have, you know, also so, sometimes designed to deal with the most complicated, you know, events. You know, you say, okay, my athlete is going to be mentally tough, and you realize it's not the case at all. They are the human being. You know? So again, I'm rambling because there's so much to say, you know, and then I get to the few strategies that we have in terms of the sleep side, for example. You know, the other ones, you know, you have the RP in the morning, you know, you have the, you know, the all the controllables that I mentioned. You know, we don't have to go over all the technologies and the tools in place in 2020. We all know this, you know. The one thing I question, you know, for me to go deeper into the fatigue topic is that, if an athlete is mentally fatigued, you know, and it's the mental side, you know, the subjective is the one I'm trying to get a good grasp on. Then the same task, the task that they do every day is going to become more challenging to them, you know. So it's like a slippery slope, you know. It's like a never-ending process, you know. Fatigue is never, you know, the acute fatigue is not a problem, but the issue that you get with the fatigue are always like cumulative, you know, efforts or strains on and off the field that end up, you know, taking their toll. And you have to be out there being able to see the signs. Curry was saying this is that, you know, if I miss a three throw, then it's then people are going to be judging, you know, as a technical miss, but 9 times out of 10 is that, you know, it's the mind, you know, it's the mind. And that task that is so easy, if it gets late in games or if it gets late in the season or late in the cycle, when you talk about periodization, then that's what makes me miss. No different than being able to execute at the end of the game. This is sometimes also a question. It was Tim Hewitt. Tim Hewitt was talking about, and I thought it was very interesting. This is probably the most interesting thing I picked up out of all these webinars lately. Because some of them were not too good, but that's just my opinion. You know, they always say that as you get fatigued, you're more injury prone. You know, the risk of injury goes up. But he was saying, listen, you know, also as you get less fatigue, you know, your speed of execution, you know, your max speed decreases, which is true. You know, so you can always look at it from both sides. He says, you know, force is mass times speed square, and then the velocity is going down. So technically, your risk of injury should be going down as well. So that part is, you know, that you gotta respect this, you know. And so I think we're rushing to conclusion with all these topics, and I think that it's much more complicated than some people would like to make it sound. So in terms of strategy, let's say fatigue is your players are not sleeping enough, you know, for whatever reason, you know. And again, I said that this is not the only reason, but for the sake of argument, because before I answer again, I'm talking too much, but you know, because you know that when you do all these studies, you know, the KPI that are really impacting the mental fatigue are going to be, it's a training load, and within the training load, it's going to be, so it's a training load because it's going to be perceived fatigue, muscle soreness, and then the sleep and stress. So the four questions that you have during the RP and the questionnaire. But if you break down the training load, it's distance, high speed running and sprint distance. You know, these would be the three ones that definitely impact the way these guys are going to be answering the wellness questionnaire, you know. So this we know, and we can control to some extent. This has been shown over time. Now, when it comes to the sleep side of things, what can you do? I had a player in England that wasn't sleeping well, okay? And we knew this. And he was trying to sleep better. So you use all the things that you have out there available for you nowadays. So you said, okay, is your bedroom quiet? Yes, okay. How's your bed? You know, you control, bedroom. Okay, bed's taken care of. Temperature, is your bedroom cold enough? You know, they say 16 to 18 Celsius is the best temperature. Okay, good, it is. Is it completely dark? Yes, it is. So you go through all this, you know, how about your mind, you know, make sure that you don't use the white light, you know, stay away from the white light, use the night shift, you know, is really not something that, but it's better than nothing, better than anything. Get rid of the screens, you know. Take a lukewarm shower. Don't eat nutrition side. Okay, you control. Nothing to excite you, you know, starting, let's say, 4 p.m. You go extreme. No caffeine, all that stuff. Don't nap, okay? Sleep, a lot of times sleep alone, you know, because you have kids, you have the dog, you have the wife, you know, so maybe you have your own room, just to be clear. You know, can you breathe? You know, can you spread the nose? All that stuff that you know it's out there. Once it's done, okay, and you're still not sleeping. So now technology, you know, you have, you know, let's say it's fatigue science, you're using fatigue science, and he doesn't fall asleep until 3 a.m. He's doing all the things that you recommend, you know. So just like my example of the cramps, you know, you end up 9 times out of 10 in a dead hand, you know. Don't get me wrong. No, I exaggerate, you know. In half of the cases, all the protocol that you have, you know, are going to help, you know, and it's going to work, you know. It's not going to be easy because the player's got his own bio clock, but you can modify this somehow. But if it doesn't work, then what do? You know, you send him to the hospital, you know, he's going to be tested and you have all the neurological tests. And at the end of the day, you have a player that falls asleep at 3 a.m., has to wake up at 7 because he has to be at the training center. And then you have someone talking about someone who's injured, who's fatigued and is more injury prone. Then you have one. So the only option that I see for a guy like this is go play in Spain. You know, I coach in Spain. You train at 12. Oh, you know, if you really want to go by the science, then you have a training for him later in the day. But you know, obviously, it's a team sport, you know. But and this is why you make complex decisions, and this is why you have to understand that it's not all about your area. Going back to a young kid from the university, you're a little part of the equation, and then you have your set of ideas, your set of data, but the coach has got his set of data as well. And at the end of the day, he's the boss, and you cannot afford to have a player train on his own in the afternoon. Maybe you can do it once, you know, just to give him some relief during the week. But that's not, you can suggest, you cannot decide. And this is what you do. So again, you know, I mean, here I was like, there's an app in the US, it's called Calm, you know, and then LeBron James is big on it, you know. That's another thing that you can use, but you know, you get your bio clock, you can try to reset it, and then you can hope for the best, but we are limited in terms of what we can do in this particular area, a simple area of sleep, and I say simple as shouldn't because it's really overlooked when it's crucial, you know. We know people, I mean, we know in the US for sure, people don't sleep enough, I don't know, but hey, like players during confinement, and all of a sudden the sleep goes way up, you know, which could be interpreted that maybe they don't get enough in a regular setting. So we know you need 8, you need 8, and if you're a young, healthy athlete, you know, my son is track athlete, he runs for his university, he's been sleeping 12 since he's been here, he's 18, you know, and that's not abnormal. You know, and if you sleep, then maybe because you need it. And we realized that some of our guys may not need what may not get what they need. So you make sure they do. And then you have these medical cases, you have these pathological cases that you try your best, but you know, it gets to a point where you've tried everything and it's not solved.
I think that's a great way of bringing it back to that advice for young practitioners or students, because this really does come down to managing the individual, doesn't it? And we learn all the processes, we learn the data sets that we can get and all the different bits of tech that we can use. But it's still, and Darren Burgess actually on our network meeting in Manchester told some great stories that is very similar to what you're saying here, that when they were at Arsenal, we told some stories on certain players that they tried putting things in place, but it comes down to knowing the player, doesn't it? And it comes down to managing that individual, regardless of all the data sets that we can get out of it.
I had a World Cup winner from France. You know, I'm not going to name his name, but he's from France. He was playing for the New York Red Bull, and I was a consultant back then. Back when the MLS didn't have enough qualified fitness coaches, you know, and literally I was consulting for a few clubs, and I put together the coaching license, the fitness coaching license for US soccer. And obviously you can see how this is maybe 13 years later, how the league has evolved. I mean, it's incredible. He was getting hurt, and the first thing I did, because the coach was very good guy and very good coach and very smart, I said, listen, you know, we need to shut him down. You know, we need to shut him down and then really make sure we take care of this. Shutting down, meaning from team training, you know, and then really go through a strict 2 to 3 weeks physical preparation phase in order for him to give him a chance. And listen, the football, again, this is a guy that is not going to lose his football at his age in 2 to 3 weeks, you know, but, you know, if he can be 100% of his physical abilities, capacity, then it's the right way to go about things. And of course, the coach said yes and stuff. And I remember being with him, doing some physical exercising, using hurdles on the track in the afternoon. You know, we had some session on the field in the morning. And then all of a sudden, he was fit as a fiddle. He had zero body fat and stuff. And all of a sudden, you know, popping out of the conversation, you know, I don't sleep much, you know. So this guy was almost insomniac. You know, and forget hurdles, forget about, you know, all the strategy we were doing, you know, and also he was eating salads. I mean, literally salads, like the lettuce and nothing else. So again, I was like, okay, good. I'm happy.
This is coming straight after a nutrition episode, Pierre. So Matthew Jones will not be happy about hearing that after everything he went into in the previous episode.
All right, so if you can, Matthew, call me. You know, if lettuce is great, for only lettuce is great, then I could learn, you know. And then and I was like, great. He's like, what do you mean great? I was like, great, because there's a strong lead here, you know. Let's start with this, you know, let's start with this and forget about it. I remember we had the hurdles, I just knocked it down. So, all right, let's go back, you know. Let's fix this first, and then we see. You know, I mean, obviously, I was exaggerating, but it's like, well, okay, I don't spend, and nearly I don't eat. Okay, we're good. Mm-hmm. You know, and this was a big name. So, going back to you know, the simple topic of you know, how much and how well do you sleep.
I think that's such an important point, because that comes down to the real art of coaching and the skill of a practitioner to be able to, because all the players are getting a very similar coaching approach, aren't they? They're all going through the coaching model as a whole in terms of the team environment. But when you can pick the player out and just pick those individual things out that the player could potentially really benefit from, that's the really important side of coaching, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's actually what drew me into the physical, you know, like coaching. You know, when at the beginning I was talking about the career, and I said, you know, like the last coach, like quote unquote coaching I did was coaching the under 19 for the UAE, you know, qualifying the team for the Asian Cup, because they needed someone, and there was so much rotation. I had the diploma, and I ended up doing this. So this was now 6 years ago. You know, but what drew me to the physical side, and first of all, because I think I'm much better equipped to coach performance than to coach you know, the rest, and also I like it more. But my point was that you know, when you deal with when you coach when you're a physical coach, let's say, you deal with the human body and the human brain. You know, there's no referees, there's no you know, at least there's no formation. You know, all these uncontrollables I don't have, you know. I don't have the weather and all that stuff. So that's the easy part, you know, and the fact that attracted me, because yeah, I'm like, okay, this is the body, no matter where you're from, no matter how you're, you know, if you do this, then you're going to get better and you're going to get there if the method is right. But then the challenge is to develop the eye for the signs, because now you get to have this sometimes one-on-one relationship, or maybe small group relationship. So now you got to get the communication skills and also the eye to see the signs, And in this case, for example, I didn't see the signs, So on that day, if he doesn't all of a sudden, because maybe now he's saying, I have confidence in this guy. This guy maybe knows what he's doing. I don't know what prompted him to finally, because it wasn't me asking him that day, are you sleeping? It was popping up in a conversation, which in retrospect, now I'm a much better coach because I would have popped that question way, way in advance, and back then. So, but again, that's a challenge also of a performance, not only a head of performance, a performance staff. That's also how I like to break down, my staff, because let's face it, we don't have time to have conversation with all the players. And figuratively, I don't have equal time for all the players. We have players where we get along, some you get along better than some others. So you have two options. Either you're bullshitting people and saying, I will love you equal, or you say, I have more points in common with him. And then in my staff, maybe you have more things in common with him. So as long as the whole team is covered and no one slips through the cracks, then you're all set, And it could be whatever, when I was in 20, all of a sudden I was dealing with the Spanish player because I speak Spanish, and no one else was in his staff. So these guys were, one guy, again, another World Cup winner in Spain, and had a very good relationship with him because he was coming from the Basque country. I'm from the Basque country. I speak Spanish. He was just know the Spanish weather and all this. Listen, it's just all of a sudden you click, and maybe I wasn't clicking as much with some other players, but there were people in the staff that were, and that's, for me, that's a very realistic approach of a staff as opposed to say, if he's going to be fine and then you're going to be able to connect with everybody. No, it's not. That's not how it is.
I think that's just the case with a group of people, though, in general, isn't it? Like, we're not going to get on with everyone. And I think the sooner we realise that, and the fact that, and Colin Lewin spoke about this as well in a previous episode, a few episodes ago, he said exactly the same thing. He was talking more from a physio point of view, but he said exactly the same, that he used to suit the physio to the personality because he knew that that relationship could build. And it makes sense, doesn't it? We're not all going to get on.
No, absolutely not. And then it's obviously you're stepping up a notch when you're in a professional environment in football, and especially as you go up, because you end up with, it's not like you're going, I'm going to be in the street here talking to 10 people, which at Atan Beach, California, and most of them are going to be from... national rosters, you have all these different players with different, you have egos, big or not, you have it's a more complex group than the average group you're going to meet here in the street, and this is why it requires also, if your staff have different trajectories, different stories, come from different backgrounds, then you optimize your chances to cover the whole team, And then once you get this, because that's once this on paper, this approach is going to be easier because these two people are supposed to connect better. Then obviously the expertise takes over. You have to be good enough. You have to be able to deliver to really establish that strong working relationship with the athlete.
No, definitely. Now, Pierre, I can't believe that has been over an hour. It literally feels like we've been talking about half an hour, but that has absolutely flown. I know the signal has dropped out a few times, but I'm hoping that I can listen back and we've got a good amount of information there, because I think that some of the points you've raised there have been absolutely amazing and really, really valuable for coaches. I just wanted to ask a couple of things just in terms of keeping up to date with yourself. One, I think it would be great to get you back on in the future and discuss the findings from the work you're doing with FIFA. I know a lot of that will probably be released, but it'd be great to have you back on in the future just to talk through that. But I wanted to ask, is there any speaking engagements you've got coming up or anywhere that people can keep an eye on, anything coming up?
My next engagement, the vacation in France, you know, and I signed for this. I'm hoping that I'm going to be able to fly back. It's been complicated. I've had a few, I'm going to be talking to a few webinars, but nothing major in the future. And I'm not part of a club right now. I got some, like anyone else, I got a LinkedIn account, a Twitter account, but nothing, no brig, no, just like in the past, no big conventions or symposium, you know, planned, because, you know, it's harder right now to have like 1,000 people in an auditorium. So there would be things popping up. Like I said, I have a, I have a webinar planned for next week, but no, nothing major, nothing major. We're gonna have to wait for the next episode of the FFF.
Of course, definitely. No, I'll point people in the direction of your Twitter though, because it'd be good for them to keep an eye on what you're up to, and obviously when you get into the next role as well, people can stay up to date on that. But I honestly looking forward to what comes out of all the work you're doing with FIFA. But I just want to say massive thank you as well for coming on, because it's been great to speak to you and the time has absolutely flown.
Yeah, appreciate it. You know, the FIFA thing, well, there would be some countries reports produced at the end of this year, and then this would be compacted into a global report. How much of this is going to be made public? I don't know. I can speculate on this because there's a lot of confidential, you know, stuff. But I can say is that I truly believe that this is going to be it's going to make a big difference for many countries in the world, you know. And always a pleasure anytime. I want to apologize in advance, Twitter, you know, political situation in the US with the current president we have had made me, you know, like in the time I have on my hand, I throw a little bit of politics in there, but if they agree with the White House right now, you know, maybe they should stay away until November. But other than that, they're still in the middle of all this. There are a lot of performance-related articles.
Yeah, we better not get into politics, because I don't know where that's going to go. No, Pierre, thank you very much for coming on, mate. I really do appreciate it. It's great for you to give up your time, because I know you've got plenty going on at the moment as well. So it's great to have you on, and I look forward to getting this out to everyone.
All right, thanks. Good having me anytime.
Thank you very much, Pierre. We'll stay in touch.
You're welcome.